YouTube link. Since we have the YouTube link for each and every session, let us be a blessing to the Universal Church also by forwarding the link to the acquaintances of ours who are also part of the Universal Church, so that they are also benefited by the sessions we are having. Dear friends, before I come to the main topic today of Wonderful God, just a brief recap of what we have covered so far. The Hebrew word for the wonderful is Pele. And the great footballer Edson Arantes do Nascimento, that's his original name. He himself may not know what is the meaning of the Hebrew word Pele. Pele means wonderful, defies imagination, goes beyond all imagination. And whenever the Lord is blessing us, protecting us, providing for us, we can never set a boundary as to his grace. We have seen in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 21, the Lord always blesses us beyond our imagination. That's what it says. And this is part of our New Year message. I said New Year messages of two parts, part A and part B. Part A we covered last week. Part B we are finishing today. And next week onwards, we'll go back to the book of Numbers. Dear friends, our God has been creating wonder. And we have seen some examples in the scriptures. I've been using F's to make us understand the subject in a better way. The first F was family. The widow Ruth was blessed with the family. Boaz marries her. We have seen the wonder of God in operation as to how he led Ruth to the field of Boaz. She could have landed up in any other field, but she landed up only in the field of Boaz because God had great plans for her. She should become the owner of the very field where she went to glean the grains. And not only that, the greatest privilege for Ruth is she figures in the genealogy of Christ. The second F which we focused upon was fields. The Shunammite lady was doing the blessed ministry of extending hospitality to a prophet of God, Elisha. She reaped one blessing after the other. First, she had been barren. She was blessed with a son. The son died after some years. He was raised back to life by prophet Elisha. Then when there was famine in the field, she went to live in a different country. And when she came back to recover her land, miraculously she recovers her land with an added bonus to it. The added bonus is what all income had accrued on account of that land. You know, that is also given to her that she never expected. So these are the wonderful acts of the Lord, how he creates wonder in us. Last week also I had shared with you that the marketing gurus are nowadays coming up with some titles. One is customer satisfaction, second is customer delight, and third is customer exhilaration. Long before they had even given birth to customer exhilaration, that is giving the customer much more than what he had expected. Our Heavenly Father has been doing that. He has been giving devotee exhilaration. Leave alone customer exhilaration, devotee exhilaration is what he has been doing. And then we came to the third F, and that was fortune. Solomon had asked only for wisdom, but God gave him wealth beyond imagination. And there was third party certification also of Solomon's wealth. Who did the third party certification? Give me an answer in the public chat. Other than Sister Jayamala, who had replied wonderfully to my quiz, who was the person who gave third-party certification to Solomon as regards his riches and wisdom?
Princess Sheba.
Absolutely, Queen of Sheba. Very good. Nowadays, we are all seeking third-party certification for services in the hotels, services in the hospitals. Why third-party certification? Third-party certification is actually a great advertisement because it is given by a third party, a neutral party, an impartial party. And that adds punch to the advertisement. that third party has no stakes in that particular hotel or hospital or a petrol bunk, but it is giving a certificate means it is adding punch to the advertisement. And if a Jew were to proclaim about the riches and wisdom of Solomon, people would say, Kaki pilla kaki ki mundu. A Jew is bound to appreciate his king. But a third party, God chooses a third party to come and sing praises of Solomon's wisdom and riches. Now, at the end of my message last week, I brought about a suspense factor. The suspense factor is, our God is known as a wonder-creating God, wonder-causing God. Can we human beings, finite beings, cause wonder in the wonderful one? That was the question I had posed at the end of my talk or at the end of the session. Can we finite beings cause wonder in the wonderful one? That is the other side of the coin. The first three F's is all about God causing wonder. And today we will look at some F's in which we see finite human beings are creating wonder in the wonderful one. Let's start with negative and then go to the positive. Now, Brother Vijay will display the slides. First, let us finish with, this is Pele in Hebrew language. This is Pele, means wonderful God in Hebrew language. We have already meditated upon this subject. The next slide is of Ruth, bestowed with the family when she trusted the Lord, when she made that great exclamation, from now on, your people shall be my people and your God shall be my God. She entrusted her life into the hands of the Heavenly Father, and the Heavenly Father would not disappoint her. Second F after that was fields. We see the Shunammite lady approaching the king's court with a creased forehead. Creased forehead carrying so many worry lines. Whether she would be able to represent her matter, her problem to the king properly. But God arranged everything in such a way that the king's heart was moved. And she not only gets back her land, she gets back her land with a bonus. And what is that bonus? All the accrued income on that land for 7 years is given to her. And the third F was fortune. The way young Solomon was blessed by the Almighty God. He sought only wisdom, but he was given not only wisdom, but also immeasurable riches. Now we come to the fourth F, and that is familiarity. Familiarity. Dear friends, here is our Lord Jesus Christ. Brother Vijay, point a cursor at our Lord Jesus Christ. He is surrounded by people. And I'll ask you a question. From the body language of the people, do they appear friendly to Jesus or hostile to Jesus? You may answer in the public chat. From the body language in the picture scene, what do you make out? Are they hostile or are they friendly? They are hostile. And who are they? The very people amongst whom our Lord Jesus Christ grew up. After performing a lot of miracles in other places, after drawing appreciation from crowds in other places in Israel, our Lord visits his own hometown, Nazareth. And now, before I make you read Mark's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 1 to 6, Sister Jyoti will be ready. I would like to bring before you a catchy phrase which goes like this, and it is a truthful phrase also. Familiarity breeds contempt. Familiarity breeds contempt. And in the usable Hyderabadi language, Garki Murgi, I will not say anything more. I will not say anything more. You know what I am hinting at. So, dear friends, let us read Mark's Gospel, chapter 6, verses 1 to 6. The punchline is there in the verse 6, but let us see the reaction of the Nazarites when our Lord Jesus Christ comes to Nazareth. Let us see how they are reacting. Amma Jyoti, please read it out.
Yeah, Mark chapter 6, verses 1 to 6. Jesus left there and went to his hometown, accompanied by his disciples. When the Sabbath came, he began to teach in the synagogue, and many who heard him were amazed. Where did this man get these things, they asked. What's his wisdom that has been given him, that he even does miracles? Isn't this the carpenter, "Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph and Judas and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. He could not do any miracles there except lay his hands on few sick and heal them." And he was amazed at the lack of faith.
Look at that. The King James Version and other translations, they say, he marveled at their lack of faith. He marveled. Look at that. He was wonderstruck at their lack of faith. Familiarity breeds contempt. They could not accept Jesus in the way other people were accepting him. Dear friends, if you look at the human behavior all along, no prophet in his generation was accepted by the people. Generally speaking, Isaiah was not accepted most of the times by the people of his generation. Jeremiah was not accepted by the people of his generation. He was subjected to a lot of persecutions. Shall we read Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5, verses 11 and 12? Sister Jyoti, Matthew's Gospel, chapter 5.
Verses 11 and 12, yeah. "Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you."
In the same way they persecuted the prophets before you. Who are these guys to come and prophesy to us? That was the reaction of the people. And we should not be surprised. We should not be marveling. If we do not get a lot of hand claps in our own church. Okay, my smile says it all. Okay, so dear friends, a 1900 preacher has an advantage over a local pastor. A 1900 preacher, like I respect Edward Williams Garu, I respected Professor Manashe uncle, wherever they went, hand claps, good, because the congregation there is not familiar with them. The local pastor may be preaching as effectively as Edward Williams. The local pastor may be preaching as effectively as Professor Manashe also. But whether he will draw the similar appreciation? Question mark. So, dear friends, familiarity breeds contempt. And our Lord Jesus Christ was also a victim of that. And here I would like to bring a subject within a subject, and that is, when you look at the ministry of Old Testament prophets, I am giving some names: Isaiah, Jeremiah, Amos, Micah. Now, what you find common in all these prophets is the people of their generation did not accept them. And what they set out to do, listen to me very carefully, what this prophet set out to do, that is make the people repent and come back onto the right track. The Israelites were going astray. They were into idol worship at that point of time. And even as this prophets try to bring them back onto the right track, the prophets, instead of getting appreciation from the crowd, they were persecuted. They were persecuted. Some of them died as martyrs also. And now the decisive question is, give me an answer to this question. Can we regard them as successful prophets? Can we regard them as successful prophets? They did not succeed in achieving what they set out to do. What they set out to do was to make the people repent. Brother Vijay says, yes. See, unlike Jonah, who went to Nineveh and elicited the response which God was expecting, not Jonah was not expecting. Jonah was not expecting that response. He felt sad that they repented. But, you know, God expected that response from the people of Nineveh. Unlike the Ninevites, the Israelites, when their prophets prophesied, they did not accept the prophecies. Instead, they persecuted the prophets. That's what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You belong to that category of the Old Testament prophets, he says, whenever you are persecuted. So the Jonah's ministry was successful, but can we regard the prophetical ministry of Isaiah, Amos, Micah, and Jeremiah as successful? Brother Vijay says yes. So let's go slightly deep into the subject. On what basis is Brother Vijay saying that they are successful? Brother Vijay, I'm making this session slightly interactive. On what basis can we say that they are successful? Unmute and you can give an answer, or you can give an answer in the public chat. The answer is right. Yes, they were successful. Anyone else also? Give me an answer in the public chat. How can we treat those prophets as successful despite they being persecuted? Whatever God has told them to do, they have done. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. The right answer, hitting the nail on the head. They were faithful in their ministry. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. They were faithful in their ministry. They may not have elicited the response they expected from the people, but they were faithful in their ministry. And even in the parable of talents, how does the Lord commend the servant who has doubled his talents? How does the Lord commend? What are the words which the Lord uses, or the master uses, to appreciate the servant who has doubled his talents? Does he say, "Well done, my successful servant"?
Faithful servant.
Well done, my faithful servant. And now listen to the most important point. The most important point is Isaiah, Micah, Amos, Jeremiah's lives are inspiring us even after thousands of years. That means God is using them even today. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Is it not? Is not Isaiah used? Is not Jeremiah used? Is not Micah used? Is not Amos used? When we read about their lives, are we not getting encouraged even today? Yes. Their ministry is timeless. Are you understanding? So, dear friends, never get discouraged if you are persecuted by the current generation, or if you are persecuted in your local church. But, dear friends, as our Lord Jesus Christ says, if people are not accepting you, then what is the logical response? Just shrug off the dust off your feet and go to yet another place where you're accepted. Are you all with me? So that ought to be the logical, spiritual, biblical response. And our Lord Jesus Christ went to other place to minister. And similarly, when you see in the missionary journeys of Paul and Barnabas, they would first preach the gospel in the Jewish synagogues. When the Jewish synagogues rejected the gospel, then they would go to the Gentiles. Where was gospel preached first? Amongst the Jews, and then to the Gentiles. Let us look at that scripture portion, which substantiates this fact. Sister Jyoti will read it out to us. Romans chapter 1, verse 16 and 17. Romans chapter 1, verses 16.
I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile.
First it was preached to the Jews, and then to the Gentiles. Wherever Paul and Barnabas went, give me an answer in the public chat. Those of you who have read Book of Acts again and again, wherever Paul and Barnabas went, wherever Paul and Silas went, did they go to the Gentiles first or to the Jews first? Give me an answer in the public chat. Dear friends, nine times out of 10, the response would be of animosity. The response would be of hostility. And then they would share the gospel with the Gentiles. And Gentiles would welcome them with open arms. So, dear friends, human beings, finite as we are, we can create wonder in the wonderful one. We have seen negative reasons for it. Now let us look at the positive reasons, how we can create wonder in the wonderful one. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Faith already by seeing the picture, you would have guessed who is petitioning our Lord Jesus Christ. Already by seeing the picture, you must have already guessed who is petitioning our Lord Jesus Christ. The Roman centurion, Brother Stephen, right on dot. So we will not read all the 9 verses because we know the story very well. We'll go to the punchline. Okay, Luke's Gospel, chapter 7, verses 6 to 9, Luke's Gospel.
So Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion friend sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel."
Hallelujah, praise the Lord, for positive reasons. Here is a Gentile creating marvel in the marvelous one. Here is a Gentile who is creating wonder in the wonderful one. Amazing, is it not? Scriptures, sweeter than honey. So, dear friends, here is a case of a finite human being creating wonder in the wonderful one. And when you look at other translations like KJV and NKJV, what do you see? It says Jesus marveled at his faith. Jesus marveled at his faith. This centurion has caused wonder in the wonderful one. So, dear friends, but still, the wonderful one is a wonderful one. No, hallelujah, praise the Lord. Lord Jesus Christ is Lord Jesus Christ. So let's go back to Luke's Gospel, chapter 7. Let us read from verse 9 onwards, Sister Jyoti.
When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I have not found such great faith even in Israel." Then the men who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well.
Now, the wonderful one, Lord Jesus Christ, has to be a wonderful one always. What did the centurion ask? The centurion's petition was, "Lord, speak one word. Lord, speak one word, and my servant will be healed." Is it not? Again, I repeat. What were the words? What were the words of the centurion? The words of the centurion was, "Lord, speak one word and my servant will be healed." Lord Jesus Christ did not speak that one word also and he was healed. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Again, our Lord goes beyond imaginations, again beyond our expectations. Amazing, is it not? Did our Lord Jesus Christ say, "Now I am saying, your servant is healed"? Did he speak that word? No. Here we see. Then the men who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well. He only said, "I found great faith in this man." What was the petition? Again, I'm going to that point. What was the petition of the centurion? "Speak one word, O Lord, and my servant will be healed." And the Lord Jesus Christ did not speak that word also. And yet the servant was healed. So the wonderful one is always the wonderful one. He has the last laugh, as it were. If he had spoken, then case of customer satisfaction. Customer is getting what customer wanted. But it has always been a case of customer exhilaration, is it not? When it comes to the acts of the wonderful one. So he's not speaking that one word also. Yet the servant is healed. Amazing, is it not? So, dear friends, what should be our prayer? What should be our prayer is, Lord, just speak one word whenever I am in difficulty. Even if you do not speak, Lord, think one word. Think one word. And Lord, we would be healed. Dear friends, when our Lord Jesus Christ was speaking to Thomas, the doubter, he said, Thomas, you're seeing me and believing me. Blessed are those who do not see me yet believe in me. I'll ask you a question. Dear friends, Benno brothers, Benno, I'm just getting call repeatedly from Mrs. Samuel uncle. Maybe she's not able to log in. She's calling me. Just have a word with her.
Yes.
Muting yourself. So, then dear friends, let's come to the point. Point is, the wonderful one always leaves us wonderstruck. And here in the case of the centurion, he only petitioned, Lord, speak one word. And even that word was not spoken. And when he came to the doubting Thomas also, our Lord Jesus Christ says, Thomas, you have seen me and you have believed in me. But more blessed are those who have not seen me, yet have believed in me. Now I'll ask you a question. If our Lord Jesus Christ is the bridegroom, what is the word used for the church? Very elementary question.
Bride,
very good. So the birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ is celebrated as ... Tell me. Birthday of our Lord Jesus Christ, we commemorate as what festival? Birthday of the bridegroom. Christmas, very good. Birthday of the bride? Give me an answer. We are getting to the main topic. We are coming to the church. Very good. Now, Acts 2. What is that festival?
Pentecost.
Pentecost. Very good. Very good. Right answer. So, dear friends, listen to me very carefully. Sometimes in the Catholic churches, the focus is on Mary, on which supernatural work of the Holy Spirit was done, rather than on our Lord Jesus Christ. And in Protestant churches also, in some denominations, unfortunately, the focus is on the apostles rather than the 3,000 who accepted the Lord on the day of Pentecost. They were the first fruits, virtually, who entered the church. Apostles' testimony, listen to me very carefully. Apostles' testimony is, we have seen, we have heard, we have touched Lord Jesus Christ. What is the testimony of the 3,000 people who accepted the Lord on the day of Pentecost and took baptism in Jesus' name? I'm emphasizing that. They took baptism in Jesus' name. Apostles took baptism of John the Baptist, whereas the 3,000 took baptism in Jesus' name. What is the difference between that baptism and this baptism? When John the Baptist baptized, Jesus' blood was not yet shed. So the hearts of the apostles was not yet cleaned by the blood of Jesus. As the blood of Jesus had not cleaned their hearts, the Holy Spirit did not come into their hearts. Whereas in the case of 3,000, as they took baptism in Jesus' name, acknowledging the atoning death of Jesus Christ in their lives, appropriating the atoning death of Jesus Christ in their life, their hearts were cleansed by the blood of Jesus. And from day one, a measure of Holy Spirit was given to them. Are you understanding the difference? Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Between apostles and the 3,000. We come under the category of 3,000 people. Our testimony is not we have seen, we have heard, we have touched Lord Jesus Christ. Our faith has come by hearing of the gospel. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Where does it say faith comes by hearing of the gospel? Faith doesn't come by seeing. If you see, there is no need for faith. If you touch, there is no need for faith. But when you hear without seeing, that is where faith comes into the picture. Please read Romans chapter 10, verse 17. We have a specialist in our group who specializes in teaching the book of Romans, Brother Stephen.
Consequently, faith comes from hearing the message, And the message is heard through the word of Christ.
Look at that. Faith comes by hearing of the message. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. And no less a person than Apostle Peter, who led the 3,000 to the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. He appreciates this 3,000. By appreciating that 3,000, he is appreciating us who belong to that category of 3,000. We do not belong to the category of apostles. We don't have to go to the upper room to wait for the Holy Spirit to come. When we acknowledge and appropriate Jesus' death on the cross, in our personal lives, our hearts are cleansed by the blood of Jesus, and we become the temple of the Holy Spirit. And yes, afterwards, anointing also takes place as we grow in the Lord, as we grow in the word. The Lord, at one point of time, finds us fit to be an apostle or an evangelist or a prophet or a pastor or a teacher. At that time, he anoints us. That's a different Holy Spirit experience. But Holy Spirit comes from day one of a person being genuinely born again. So, dear friends, let us see Peter himself appreciating this 3,000. From which all places this 3,000 came? Let's look at Acts chapter 2, verse 9. Let us look at the places from which this 3,000 came on the day of Pentecost.
Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya near Cyrene, visitors from Rome, both Jews and converts of Judaism.
Thank you, sister. You can see that places, Cappadocia, Pontus, Asia, Asia, it says, in some translations, it is Asia. Let us look at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. Brother Vijay also will display. To whom is Peter writing his first epistle?
Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to God's elect, strangers in the world, scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. He is writing that epistle to that very 3,000 people who had gone back to their respective cities and established churches there. He's writing to them only. And look at his words of appreciation. They all come under the category of the Roman centurion. Okay? The 3,000 who accepted the Lord on the day of Pentecost, they come under the category of the Roman centurion. Let's go to verse 7, sister.
These have come so that your faith, of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed.
Continue.
Though you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Peter, the apostle himself, is appreciating the 3,000. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Though you have not seen him, you have faith in him. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Are you understanding? Who is appreciating? Peter himself. So, dear friends, when we do not see him, when we do not touch him, even then when we believe in him, we come under the category of that Roman centurion whose faith was appreciated by our Lord Jesus Christ. He said, he marveled at his faith. And he said, this kind of faith I have not seen in the land of Israel. That is amongst the Jews. Even in the Jews, amongst the Jews, that kind of faith was not seen. Are you all with me? So we come under the category of the 3,000 who accepted the Lord on the day of Pentecost. And we do not come under the category of the apostles. We have to remember that fact. Okay. So then we will come to the last slide. And that is Peter, James, and John, the early apostles, how they caused wonder in the Jewish religious leaders. You can see them wondering. Brother Vijay, point a cursor at the religious leaders. One of them is holding his hand like this on his mouth. He's thunderstruck, he's wonderstruck as to how Peter and John are preaching the gospel with so much of conviction and so much of authority. There they are standing in the Sanhedrin and proclaiming the gospel. They are telling Under the sky, there is no other name other than the name of Jesus which can save. Please read Acts chapter 4, verses 12 and 13, sister.
Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and they took note that these men had been with Jesus.
They were astonished. So, dear friends, what will cause astonishment, wonder in the hearts of unbelievers? What will cause astonishment in the hearts of unbelievers is, we Christians, how we can cause astonishment, how we can cause marvel, how we can cause wonder in the hearts of unbelievers is by way of our witness, by way of our witness. Look at the witness of Peter, James, and John. They were completely flabbergasted when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized they were unschooled, ordinary men. They were astonished, it says. Dear friends, more than preaching, Jesus has called all of us to be witnesses. Are you all with me? What is your first priority as a Christian? More than preaching, what is the first priority is being a witness, being a witness. And if you look at the sequencing of the words in the Bible, A will never come, before A, B will never come. Okay, before B, C will never come. What do I mean by that? The words in the scriptures are inspired by the Holy Spirit. And even the sequencing of the words is inspired by the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Are you all with me? I'll give you two examples and come to the main point as to how witness is more important than even preaching. Okay? We'll go step by step. Please read John's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 22. John's Gospel, chapter 4, verse 22.
You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews.
Continue, sister.
For yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the God Father sees.
Now, look at the sequencing of the words in verse 23. We need to worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Does it say in truth and in spirit? Or does it say in spirit and in truth? It says in spirit and in truth. What does it mean? Look at the sequencing of the words inspired by the Holy Spirit. It is not truth and spirit. It is rather spirit and truth. Means what? We can worship the Lord in a manner which is acceptable to the Lord only with the help of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Can any one of us worship the Lord properly with our own puny finite strength? I'm asking you a question. Can we worship the Lord properly with in a way which is acceptable to the Father with our puny finite strength? No. It is the Holy Spirit which makes our worship acceptable to the Father. There are times when we start worshiping Him in the privacy of a room. You know, tears will start flowing. Words will not come out of the mouth. There'll be only be groans. And that is why I always say, church prayer is important. Family prayer is more important. And personal prayer is most important. I repeat, church prayer is important. Family prayer is more important. But personal prayer is most important. Reason is, in the church congregation, perhaps we may feel a bit insecure if we shed tears and pray, thinking, what will other church members think about us? Similarly, in front of the family, in front of children, suppose we cry and pray, we may think, what will children think? But in the privacy of a room, You can open your heart fully and pray. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. You can open your heart fully and worship the Lord. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Nobody will feel offended by your crying. Nobody will feel or think otherwise when they see you crying like a little child. That is what our Heavenly Father wants. Turn with me to Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27. Brother Stephen is already making a nice guess, I know. Romans chapter 8, verses 26 and 27. What does it say?
In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groans that words cannot express.
With groans that words cannot express. Are you all with me? Only tears will be flowing. Words also will not come. That's why I say the sequencing of the words in the scripture is also inspired by the Holy Spirit. The sequencing, not only the entire Bible is inspired by the Holy Spirit, the sequencing of the words is also inspired by the Holy Spirit. Worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, not in truth and in spirit. Your worship becomes truthful only when the Holy Spirit is helping you. Are you with me? Then, one more example of proper sequencing of words before I come to the point that witnessing is greater than preaching. Okay, so let's go to Acts chapter 1, verse 1. Acts chapter 1, verse 1. Sister will read it out.
In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach.
I'll ask you a question. What does it say? Does it say Jesus began to teach and to do, or first to do and to teach? First to do and to teach. We live in an era where people say, hey, you should practice what you preach. Good. Very good. You should practice what you preach. But Jesus did something better. You know what he did? He first practiced and then preached. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Began to do and to teach. At a time our Lord Jesus Christ was baptized. Listen to me very carefully. At a time our Lord Jesus Christ was baptized, there is a heavenly commendation coming from the Heavenly Father. Heavenly Father himself is giving witness. What is he telling about our Lord Jesus Christ? This is my son and I am well pleased with him. Now I am asking you a question. Did Jesus already start his ministry at that point of time? Has he already preached sermons at that point of time? Has he already done miracles at that point of time? Give me an answer.
No.
In the 30 years of his life prior to his ministry, what all Jesus was going to do, what all Jesus was going to preach, he had already practiced. Are you all with me? So when he says, go into the privacy of the room and pray, he himself had gone into the privacy and prayed. If he says, love your enemies, he has already loved his enemies. Are you all with me? Sermon on the Mount. There was so much of conviction. There was so much of authority in his message that people's hearts were moved. From where did he get that conviction? From where did he get that authority? Because he was already practicing and then preaching. Are you all with me? Does the Bible say that when the people heard the Sermon on the Mount, their hearts were inspired by the conviction of the words of our Lord Jesus Christ? Let's go to Matthew's Gospel chapter 7, the last verses. Matthew's Gospel chapter 7. The last verse. Please read the last two verses, Ma.
When Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were amazed at his teaching because he taught as one who had authority and not as a teacher of the law.
They were amazed. Once again, wonder. The wonderful one is causing wonder in the hearts of his audience. Why? Because there was so much of authority and conviction in his voice. Why? Because he was already practicing and then preaching. Are you all with me? The sequencing of the words is also inspired by the Holy Spirit. It is not worship the Lord in truth and in spirit. It is worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. Jesus' ministry was not about teaching and doing. It was all about doing and teaching. And now I'm coming to the point as to why witnessing is so important. Turn with me to Acts chapter 8, verse 25. Let us look at the sequencing of the words. Acts chapter 8, verse 25. Can we read in King James Version rather than NIV? King James is more closer to the original. Sister Jyoti, if it is possible.
James.
Or it can be read in Telugu also. Whoever is having the Bible, you can unmute and read. Because Telugu is closest to the original.
I cannot read. So.
No problem. Sister Jayamala or anybody else? Or Sister Sheba, Pastrama? You can unmute and read. English
cold.
Bible.
The verse
Latin and then
antata varu sakshamichuchu prabhu vakyamu bodhinchi.
Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Valu sakshamichuchu prabhu vakyam bodhinchiri. Prabhu vakyam bodhinchi saksham palikiri and ledu. The word of God doesn't say that they preached and then they gave their witness. No, first they testified, first they gave witness. And then they preach the word of the Lord. Are you all with me? So, dear friends, the Jewish religious leaders were marveling, they were wonderstruck by the witness of Peter and John. They were awestruck by the testimony of Peter and John. Now, dear friends, I'll come to one important point and then I will close in another 5 minutes. I'll ask you a question. What is that one civic wonder in India, which is one of the wonders of the world? A civic wonder.
Taj Mahal.
Taj Mahal, very good. People come from different parts of the world to see Taj Mahal. Is it because nobody can build yet another Taj Mahal? Are you with the modern day technological advances, with the engineering skills which people have, thanks to the modern day advancement in technology, better structures than Taj Mahal can be built easily at that. Not only better structures than Taj Mahal can be built, it can be built easily. But what is attracting the public to Taj Mahal from different countries, leave alone India? What is attracting? Expression of love. Very good. Hitting the nail on the head, Brother Stephen. How much a husband has loved his wife. And you know what St. Augustine says about our testimony and our witnessing? You know what he says? The 5th century Christian saint, St. Augustine, says, Jesus is most glorified. Not when we preach, not when we prophesy, not when we teach, not when we do healing. Jesus is most glorified when people observe that he is more precious to us than all that life can give or death can take away. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. I repeat, Jesus is most glorified when people observe that he is more precious to us than all that life can give or death can take away. That is the extent of love we have for Jesus, which should be seen by the unbelievers. Hey, this man loves the Lord more than his own life. This man loves the Lord more than anything else. Abraham, you have proven that you love me more than your beloved son Isaac. Are you understanding? That glorifies the Lord more than anything else. And let me conclude. Because this is Bible study, I am going a bit deep. What was Elisha's request when Elijah was about to be raptured?
That double portion of the spirit.
Double portion of the spirit. So, let me share with you that when you look at the scriptures, Elijah performed 14 miracles. How many miracles Elijah performed? 14 miracles. Elisha performed 27 miracles and died. Double portion. He should have performed 28 miracles, no? But look at the scriptures. Elijah performed 14 miracles. Elisha performed 27 miracles and died. Are you one number short? After passage of time, you know, in Hyderabad, all gudas are there to depict all the burial ground cemeteries. Narayan Guda, Safil Guda, Mettu Guda, all gudas.
Boy Guda.
Boy Guda. Me and brother Benoni Richards have been active in getting burial grounds for the Christian community. Okay, that's a different story altogether. Please pray that all our efforts will bear fruit. Already it has borne fruit in a way that the TRS government has allotted almost 65 acres of land in the outskirts of Hyderabad to bury the dead bodies of the Christian community. Anyway, I'll come to that on a different day. But coming to the main point is, after due passage of time, Israelites bring one dead body to be buried in Narayan Guda, where Elisha is buried. And when they are bringing the dead body, they observe that some robbers are coming to rob them. And they are frightened. They want to run away from that place, the relatives of the dead man. So they just put that body in haste into that burial ground. And by accident, we say, but by providence, God says, that body falls on the grave of Elisha the prophet, and that dead man comes to life, and the 28th miracle is done. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Case of dead bones also having life. Are you all with me? Why am I bringing all this? I'm closing with a real life example as to how witness of a Christian is so impactful, is so effective. Who was the pioneer missionary to China? If I ask you that question, the answer would be Hudson Taylor, right? Now, after Hudson Taylor had finished his ministry, after he had passed away, after he rested with his fathers, as it were, to use a biblical language, you know, after some years, China came under the communist government. The communist government took over the reins of administration virtually. And they found out that the churches established by Hudson Taylor were flourishing. And, you know, they hatched a wicked conspiracy to uproot these churches. You know, what was that wicked conspiracy? To defame the name of Hudson Taylor, to tarnish his image, whereby his testimony will get spoiled, and even the name of our Lord Jesus Christ would be tarnished. Are you all with me? So they deputed a special officer. His special mission was, go to all the places where Hudson Taylor ministered, observe his ministry, scrutinize his ministry with a magnifying glass. I'm using figurative language. Scrutinize his ministry with magnifying glass. Find out the loopholes in his ministry. Find out where all he has misappropriated money. Find out where all he has done unlawful, find out where all he has indulged in unlawful activities. Then file a report. We will publish this report in the national newspaper. That was their plan. So that publicly, nationally, Hudson Taylor's name would be tarnished. Okay? And the special officer was on a mission. He was getting salary from the Chinese government. So he went to all the places where Hudson Taylor ministered and used the magnifying glass to scrutinize his ministry. And lo and behold, like the enemies of Daniel, he could not find any fault in the way Hudson Taylor ministered. There was no misappropriation of funds. Rather, what he found out was the commitment of Hudson Taylor, the sacrificial ministry of Hudson Taylor, the length, the breadth, the depth and height of love Hudson Taylor had for the Lord, and the Holy Spirit convicted this special officer and he became a Christian, and dead Hudson Taylor won a soul to the Lord. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Just like dead Elisha raised the dead man. Are you with me? What is witness all about? When people observe that Jesus is more precious to us than all that life can give or death can take away, that will take their breath away. That will take their breath away. That will make them marvel at the marvelous one. That will make them wonder at the wonderful one. Our testimony, our witness, how much we are loving the Lord, not only by way of our words, by way of our actions, when people observe. And let me tell you, there is death for a person, there is no death for a testimony. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Long after Elisha died, the power was there in the grave to raise yet another dead man. Long after Hudson Taylor died, there was power in the testimony to win a soul for the Lord. Hallelujah, praise the Lord. Are you all with me? We are on the subject of wonders. A dead Hudson Taylor brought a dead person in sin to the Lord. Means virtually that person is resurrected. You know what is the condition of a person who has not accepted the Lord? Ephesians chapter 2 verse 1, what does it say? You are dead in your sins and trespasses. You are dead in your sins and trespasses, and the Lord raised you spiritually alive. Are you all with me? So, dear friends, we'll close here. What are the three F's which we focused upon? First, today. First was familiarity. Second is faith. And third is firm. The firm stand of Peter and John, willing to put their lives at risk for the Lord. They knew this Jewish Sanhedrin can again conspire like they conspired against Lord Jesus Christ, and they can hand them over to Romans for a death penalty. They knew, but they stood up, and the Jewish religious leaders were awestruck, wonderstruck. Are you all with me? So we'll close here and let us sum up all the F's. First F, family. Second F, fields. Third F, fortune. Fourth F, with which we started today, is familiarity. Fifth is faith. And sixth is firm. Okay. Next week, we will restart our Bible study on the book of Numbers. We'll close here. The person who is designated to make the closing prayer is none other than our dear brother, Benner. He will lead us in closing prayer. And after that, Brother Benno will lead us in the Lord's Prayer. I'll pronounce a benediction, and Benno's family will lead us in singing of the doxology.